Hey guys, so getting towards the end of this module, it's exciting times. I'm excited to be here, can't be more energized. It's a Thursday afternoon, it's raining outside. I'm all about this. This is going to be awesome. So, what are we going to cover in these two videos for this session? Audiences, and I call my audiences lectures Ancient History, Myths, and Web 2.0. I'm anti-audience theory. Most audience theory is outdated and has a really dehumanizing view of human beings ourselves, which I find really problematic. So, in the concept of what, in the context of what I'm going to do over these two videos is I'm really going to look at what's problematic about traditional audience theory, look about what's better about audience theory that was developed in the 70s and 80s. But it's not ideal in terms of what an audience is today, because as an audience today, we are radically different. And we're hyperactive. We're not just an active audience, we're a hyperactive audience. But I'll get into most of that in video two. Video one is really going to be my hatchet job on audience theory in the past. So really, in these two videos, I want to look at what is an audience, media effects, encoding and decoding is an important set of categories and concepts that we need to understand. Very briefly, going to look at Yanang's study of Dallas, and that as a pivotal changing point in how we consider audiences. A big critique of audience theory, and the rise of what my colleague William Mehring calls media, and the sort of mediums that we're using and platforms today which don't fit easily into a conceptual model that audience theory gives. So, what is an audience? In media studies, the term audience usually refers to an assembly of listeners or viewers who come together, if only virtually, through shared consumption of film, television, radio, the internet, music, or advertising, or indeed Leighton's lectures. You're an audience, right? Because you are coming together with other people to experience the same media as them. So, really, that's what we're referring to as an audience. Traditionally, audience theory derives out of mass audiences like this image of American cinema audiences in the 1940s. But we need to think about different audiences in this day. So, that image of an audience in the past, we have audiences today, it could be internet users in China consuming different games, which many people play at once, or all being on the same platform, like WeChat, for example. This is a slightly different audience dynamic because although you've got lots of different people doing the same things at the same time, they might be doing it in a completely different way to one another, and they might have different uses and different ways of approaching that medium, for example. So audiences still exist. It's not a case anymore that we don't have audiences anymore, but their behavior and the way we think about them may have to change. I've mentioned Theodora Adorno in this module a lot, and sort of the key underpinning to early audience research was the work that Adorno did with radio audiences in the 1930s and 40s, and how he wanted to understand how people were influenced by mass media and how people, if you like, were the same as one another when they were having the same experiences. And that notion of a uniform audience is really important in the kind of theories of audience which emerged in the wake of Adorno's work. They're all based on this linear model of communication, which I talked about really in the first set of videos for this module when I looked at Shannon, Claude Shannon and Weaver's model of this understanding of media as being a very simple linear process. Somebody sends a message, there's a medium and there's a receiver. And really the direction is one way. You send something to a receiver, and that's a linear model of communication. That kind of thinking led to audience theories which viewed human beings as incredibly dumb, stupid, and really not autonomous beings at all. So these, if you've studied media before, I'm sure you're going to be familiar with some of these terms. But the hypodermic needle theory, which isn't really a theory at all in any real sense, is this idea that media push messages into the audience. So we sit there and we receive audience messages. just as kind of brain-dead sponges to what the media transmits. Basically a model of brainwashing. It's complete nonsense. It's total nonsense because of what it says human beings are. Human beings are just entirely passive lumps of carbon that just consume media. It's an idiotic vision of what the human being is. Following on from that, you have the two-step flow model from Lazarsfeld and Katz. So their idea was that key respected individuals mediate the message of the media. We have opinion leaders, and they're, you know, and the media to an extent creates these opinion leaders as well as they exist organically outside of media. And if they say things, we accept them. Again, this view of the human in this is pretty grim. You know, ooh, look, pretty person, I listen. Ooh, look, important man, I listen. Really? You know, it's a very sort of bleak view of the human being as well. I can understand why Lazarsfeld and Katz's model has some things going for it, because definitely this is a technique used in the media, and particularly in things like PR and advertising. But at the same time, it does not take into account that the human being might bring something to the party rather than just being a dumbass. The uses and gratifications theory comes along a lot later, McQuayle and Katz in 1974, and it is more focused on why people use media. So it's starting to show some indications of an active audience, but the view of the audience here is just purely as some kind of hedonistic machine. We only consume media that we enjoy and love and we get something from. And it's like, actually, that's not true. We consume a lot of media that we don't get a great deal from. Excuse me, I'm just having a yawn there. Whoa, I need to get more sleep. Like you guys, for example, you're consuming this at the moment. You hate me, and you hate the message, and you hate this course, and you hate this module, and you hate everything. But you're still here watching it, because you're duty-bound to watch this stuff. There's not exactly hedonism involved in it, right? You know, so uses and gratifications, kind of interesting when we think about social media usage, kind of interesting when we think about generally something like YouTube, where you have unlimited, virtually unlimited choice on what you can watch on YouTube, but you watch a certain, you know, sort of cache of things over time. So I think uses and gratifications theory has some positives still, but again, its view of the audience is pretty limited. Really, these viewpoints on audience belong to a sort of school of thought called the media effects model. Now, the effects model is the idea that mass media contains clear messages which impact on a passive audience. People may copy things they've seen in the media, you know. So I watch Itchy and Scratchy, and what's the first thing I go out and do? I chop someone's heads off with an axe because I've seen it on the cartoon. The cartoon cat did it to the cartoon mouse, so the mouse actually does it to the cat in Itchy and Scratchy. I saw it and I did it, you know. It's most traditionally framed at the moment in the video games argument, right? You know, violent video games makes violent people. I play loads of violent video games and I'm a pacifist. How does that work? You know, I'm not a pacifist when I'm playing video games. I'm killing left, right and center. But, you know, it doesn't really relate to my everyday life. I don't go out fighting with people. I don't go around hitting people. I don't go around beheading people with axes. At times, it seems like an attractive proposition to me. Like, you know, I'm waiting for a queue outside somewhere and thinking, you know, it's starting to rain and thinking I could really behead this person right now. But I don't do it. I have control, and I recognize that in civil society, and we're trying to have a civilization here, people, in civil society, you know, we have rules and we have laws and we have social norms, and just, you know, decapitating randoms is not part of civil society. Because I'm a fully formed human being. You know, I understand behavior, I understand consequence, I understand action, I understand all these things. And this is why when I play violent video games or watch violent cartoons or watch violent movies, and let's be fair, my friends, the only good movies are movies that have high amounts of sex and violence in them. And I'm consuming these texts all the time, but I'm not acting on them. I'm not going out there and battering people. You know, I'm not going out there and pummeling people with manhole covers. I'm just not doing it. So the effects model takes a very, very simple view of what human beings are and doesn't really take into account the complexity of human beings. The effects model is highly influenced by some really dubious work like Albert Bandura's Bobo Doll experiment. Now, This is one of the stupidest things I've ever seen in my life, and I have a degree in psychology, and even then I thought it was really stupid, right? In the early 60s, Bandura does a set of experiments with children where he shows children a video of a adult either interacting with or, you know, smashing up what's called a Bobo doll. A Bobo doll's kind of a 3-4 foot large sort of painted object with a large round base to it, so when you hit it, it comes back up all the time, and the base is weighted and so on. It's usually got a big like smiley face on it, or clown face or something like that. So kids would watch, you know, either adult acting okay with this thing or acting violently towards it. They were then put into a room with a Bobo doll and a set of objects in there, you know, and they might have seen an adult hitting the Bobo doll with a hammer or something, and there's a hammer there. And then Bandura observed what the kids did to the Bobo doll, and unsurprisingly, really, he found that, you know, kids who'd watched adults being violent were violent towards the Bobo doll. Kids who watched them not being violent weren't likely to be violent towards the Bobo doll. What does this prove? Absolutely nothing. Bandura's work was, which is called social learning theory, was meant to illustrate that, you know, if kids observe adult violence enough on TV, obviously because it was a video thing, right, then they'll be violent. This is one of the stupidest things I've ever heard in my life. This is a completely artificial setup. You know, first of all, you'd never watch a TV show like that. Secondly, you'd never be put into the exact same circumstances of the television show, like minutes after you've seen it. Thirdly, some guy's not going to give, like, infants a hammer. You know, it's completely unrealistic, and it's completely devoid of any kind of real-world context. What's going on here? So Bandura takes a completely artificial situation and extrapolates it to the real world. It's a very, very stupid experiment. But it's a foundational basis for this effects model, which says, you know, people are dumb, people are like infants, and people will copy what they see on TV. And therefore, we should limit violence on TV. We should limit graphic sexual content. And I'm like, damn it, no, I want violence. Hate Bandura. So, to assert that, say, media violence will bring negative consequences assumes that the medium holds a singular message which should be carried unproblematically to the audience. This is David Gauntlet in 1998. And I've asked you to read Gauntlet this week as a response to media effects. What Gauntlet is really saying here is that and what's important here is this idea of carried unproblematically. We don't receive messages from the media directly. We have things like memories, and stuff we've learned, and stuff we know. And our reception of media texts is conditional on these things. You know, different people receive different media texts in different ways because we are all different to one another, first of all, whereas, you know, the effects model assumes we're roughly the same. And secondly, it assumes that all our prior learning, all our prior understanding of the world, everything that makes us a human being is actually completely unimportant. And you will just copy what you see on the screen. It's moronic. And its view of human beings is moronic. And this is really what Gauntlet is trying to get at here. You know, this is media studies for morons. This is not good. And really, those early audience theories are foundationally very similar to the effects model. You know, they assume, like, you know, as an audience, we sit there and it all just comes in. You know, we listen to the guy and then we believe it. You don't do that. That doesn't happen, you know, but that is really what the audience theories from, you know, history are telling us. So it's a very, very limited view of what human beings are. So this linear model of communication is really, really problematic. The idea that we're just a receiver at the end that brings nothing to the party, that's really, really problematic. Stuart Hall, in his work on encoding and decoding model of meaning transmission, makes an important, you know, addition to this model. So he retains this notion of encoding and decoding being a, you know, a sort of a linear path, but he brings into this notion that there are lots of different factors that shape both ends of the communication process, and so therefore finally gives human beings some credit as the decoders of information, and indeed recognizes that there's a lot going on at encoding, that media messages are not simple in themselves. There's a lot going on there. So, for example, here we got a particularly, you know, batshit example. Well, actually, what am I saying? Particularly batshit, completely normal thing from Fox News. the left's plot to silence conservatives. Spoiler alert, there is no such plot. Never was, never has been. So Hall's idea of, like, you know, how do audiences actually act with these things? He proposes that there are three different ways, really, that we can receive a message, or how we decode it. We have a preferred reading, so it affirms the hegemonic order, basically, we agree with it. An oppositional reading that challenges that hegemonic order, we're against what's being transmitted to us. And a negotiated reading, a mix of the two, right? So a preferred reading here would be the left is silencing conservatives because I'm a moron. The oppositional reading, the far right are insane. Yes, with a but. Negotiated reading, political discourse is oppositional and both sides are engaged in a war of supremacy on political discourse. Yeah, sounds like my position on it, really. So Hall starts to give the audience some credit. Says that we're bringing something to the party and we're doing something, you know, and we're, and unsurprisingly, Stuart Hall's theories are really grouped under this heading of active audience. You know, we are active in what we do. We don't just sit there like morons. We actually engage with these things. We have thoughts, we have personality, we have opinions, and we have knowledge. We bring that to the party and we are involved in this reading of things, which is quite important. Much better than the previous theories, right? Fisk uses the term audiencing to refer to the process by which something like a visual image has its meanings renegotiated or even rejected by particular audiences watching it in specific circumstances. And the reason why I bring up audiencing is it's a nice verb to try and understand what an active audience does. We are audiencing. We are doing something when we are engaged with media. You know, we don't just sit there, but we are active in what we're doing. And audiencing is a nice verb to describe what that is. And as I said, Yang Ang's work on Watching Dallas is a really important marker in this transformation of our view of audiences as human beings, really. Ang put a newspaper advertisement out and it read like this. I like watching the TV serial Dallas, but often get odd reactions to it. Would anyone like to write to me and tell me why you like watching it too or dislike it? I should like to assimilate these reactions in my university thesis. Please write to, and then she gave her address. It's one of the first full-scale audience pieces of audience research which actually asks questions like this. Why do you like it? Why do you dislike it? What do you get from it? How, you know, you watch Dallas, why? What is going on here? I watch Dallas. Why do you watch it? And so a really interesting piece of audience research came out here where she looked at the motivations of why people engage with a particular media text. It hadn't been done that way, but it was actually a humanizing piece of research, which treating the audience as individuals who had their own reasons for doing things and trying to understand what those reasons were. It's a vast improvement on the kind of moronic media effects style theory that says we just watch because, like, you know, we just understand and then we do it. That's not how people work, and that's not how we do things with the media either. And so Ang is a really important marker. That's all I've got to say on audience in this video, but in the next video, I'll be all over why perhaps even this stuff doesn't go far enough in contemporary media circumstances. Cheers, guys.